You've been my life for so long. You were right when I was wrong. I can't repay all the love you've given me. You were my friend when no one cared. I was alone, but you were there. Lord, you're the best thing that's ever happened. Borrowed dreams, all life's joys you've given me. When troubles come, you're always there to make me smile. Let come what may, thy will be done. I love you, Jesus, God's precious Son. Lord, you're the best thing that's ever happened to me.
On that day, we will see. Well, good evening and welcome again to Grange Baptist Church. And as we come to another week of Bible study, this very well could be the last week of Bible study we meet together in this format. As we know, of course, the government announced last week that they'd be giving clear indication as to when fellowships like ourselves could meet together. And thus, as we await that guidance and indeed further instruction from the government, and indeed anticipate entering into the month of July, we as a leadership here have some decisions to make this week in regards to how the current our format will progress, and indeed if it will progress in its current form or not. And so be praying for us as we make those decisions, and we'll seek to communicate them as clearly as we can over the course of next weekend, this coming weekend, God willing, as we arrive at those decisions as led of the Lord. But nevertheless, we're coming to consider and continue our thoughts and men that we can learn from. It will be a series that we do continue through the summer months, so it won't be the end of these messages, rather just perhaps the end of the current format of broadcasts. And we'll continue this series right through into the early autumn, no doubt. We've still several key characters in Scripture that we wish to come to and indeed learn from. And we pray that the Lord will continue to bless them to each of our hearts. And this week we're considering the lives of groups of three men each night. And so tonight we come to consider Cain, Abel and Seth. And tomorrow evening we'll consider the lives of Shadrach, Meshach and Abednego. And then on Wednesday evening, in our regular prayer meeting and Bible study night, we'll consider the lives of Peter, James, and John, and specifically that time that they went up into the Mount of Transfiguration with our Lord Jesus Christ. And we pray that these thoughts over the next number of nights will truly be that source of blessing, encouragement, and edification to you. For that's our heart's desire, that as we come to the word of the Lord, we're encouraged, we're challenged, and we're built up, and that we might know the blessing of the Lord therein. We're turning in our Bibles this evening to Genesis in the chapter 4. Genesis in the chapter 4, the word of God says, "And Adam knew Eve, his wife, and she conceived and bare Cain, and said, I have gotten a man from the Lord. And she again bare his brother Abel. And Abel was a keeper of sheep, but Cain was a tiller of the ground. And in process of time it came to pass that Cain brought of the fruit of the ground an offering unto the Lord. And Abel, he also brought of the firstlings of his flock, and of the fat thereof. And the Lord had respect unto Abel and to his offering, but unto Cain and to his offering he had not respect. And Cain was very wroth, and his countenance fell." Now, pausing there just to reflect on that which we've read, let's back up to verse number 1, and let's see first of all the character of Cain. Now, Cain was the first child to be born into the world. Remember, Adam was created and formed from the dust of the ground, and then Eve was formed out of a rib that was taken from Adam, and thereby the both of them knew what it was to be created by God, by the work of God's hands, by the word of God's power. And so as we come to consider Cain, we're coming to see that first individual born into the world. And as Eve bears that child, she says these words, "I have gotten a man from the Lord." And truly she knew that the gift of Cain, the gift of a child, was a blessing from heaven, from God himself. And in our world today, so little is made of that gift of life that God gives to a mother. And especially there in the womb, when life begins at the moment of conception, so little is made of that blessing that God gives and God grants even in that moment. I know how sad it is to see those who rush to support abortion laws even here within our own land. Those willing to murder the unborn child, those willing to count so little worth the life that God has given there in the womb. Oh, it's a tragedy. And we as believers must be unafraid to take our stand and to declare boldly that we believe that life begins in the womb, and thus the protections that are afforded to fully grown individuals as well as babies, as well as in the womb, that those little infants would be protected in the same way and afforded the same rights. Oh, that God would spare us, that God would bless us, and that God would truly raise up a generation of people willing to unashamedly declare his truth, especially in that area. Now, as we come to consider that, we see then, of course, that Cain is followed by his brother Abel. And the Bible tells us in verse 2, Abel was a keeper of sheep, Cain was a tiller of the ground. Now, some have tried to make something out of the two occupations that I don't believe Scripture supports. Some have said that there was more nobility, more acceptance in the sight of God and the occupation of Abel being a keeper of sheep than there was in Cain being a tiller of the ground. But Scripture doesn't at all support that idea, for there are instances right throughout Scripture of those who were shepherds, those who pleased God being shepherds. And indeed, the Lord Jesus Christ himself was the one who was given that title, the shepherd of the sheep. The great I am the great shepherd, the great shepherd giveth his life for the sheep. That's the words of Christ himself. But he was also depicted as a sower, going forth and sowing precious seed. The one, the farmer, going into the field, casting forth that seed and expecting a harvest therefrom. And thereby, both of these occupations truly are noble in the sight of God. And there is nothing to be read into, I believe, truly the mention of what they were engaged in and what their occupation was. Rather, I believe the differentiation comes whenever they stand before God. For it tells us, in the process of time, it came to pass that Cain brought the fruit of the ground an offering unto the Lord, and Abel he also brought the firstlings of his flock and of the fat thereof. And here is where the differentiation is made between Cain and Abel, when they stood before God, when they came to worship God. And I don't believe that has changed. If you want to truly know who a person is and what they stand for, consider them in the sight of God, how they worship God, how they view God, how they seek to obey the commands and the laws of God, how they seek to hold true the word of God. That truly paints the right picture as to who an individual is and to what is truly within their heart, how they view God, how they worship God. Cain came, and he brought up the fruit of the ground, an offering unto the Lord. Was it accepted? No. The Bible tells us unto Cain, verse 5, and to his offering, he had not respect, that is, he did not accept it. Abel, the Bible tells us here, brought up the firstlings of his flock. Now that's important, because the Bible uses very careful language there to tell us that the firstlings, those first lambs that were born, Abel brought to the Lord. And that was a pattern that was established right down through Scripture, that it was to be the first fruits of the ground, it was to be the firstlings of the flock that were offered, even as the days of the Levitical system of sacrifice would be instituted. But Cain, we're just told, brought up the fruit of the ground. So both of these men, no doubt, were religious. Both of these men, remember, had been raised by Adam and Eve, those who had experienced the fall, those who knew what it was to stand perfect, but because of their transgression, to stand sinful in the sight of God, needing even that provision of the blood, the covering for their sin, just as God had done in the Garden of Eden in the slaying of the lamb and the provision of the skins even for their coverings. And in doing that, God was instituting, I believe, the way that man was to worship him post the fall. Now, there's no explicit command from God, but we see, of course, that that system of sacrifice evolves right throughout the Old Testament into the Levitical law system, and then brings us right to the point of the birth of Christ, as that Paschal Lamb is truly known here upon earth, and he gives himself a sacrifice once for sin for all mankind. And that was instituted way back in the Garden of Eden. And Adam and Eve would have raised their boys in the knowledge of God, and there's no doubt of that in my mind. They would have raised them in the fear of God, and they would have raised them with an understanding how to please God. But all along, Cain thought he knew better. In his heart, there was no regard for God. In his heart, there was no desire to please God. In his heart, there was no desire to worship God in the appropriate or the correct way. No, he simply brought up the fruit of the ground. The Bible doesn't even afford to him that commendation that it was the first fruit. No, it was just the fruit. In my mind, he's almost gathering what he just can, because he acknowledges now's the time to worship. He just grabs what's at hand and he brings it to the Lord and hopes that's good enough. Because in his mind, religion was simply what he made of it, what he could invest in it. Not Abel. Abel brought the firstlings of the flock. Why? Because Abel recognized and understood what God, the pattern for sacrifice, the pattern for worship that God had established in the Garden of Eden. He recognized that his sins could only be atoned by the death of another, the death of a substitute. That covering could only ever be known for his sin as that blood was shed of that innocent lamb. And so he came. And he worshipped God in the appropriate and the correct way. He came the way God had appointed. And the Bible tells us that God had respect unto Abel and to his offering. God accepted his offering. Now come across to 1 John, and the Apostle John here shines a further light upon this. Gives us a clear understanding of what I've been seeking to say. 1 John in the chapter 3 tells us, "For this is the message that you have heard from the beginning, that we should love one another. Not as Cain," this is verse 11 and verse 12, sorry, of 1 John chapter 3. "Not as Cain, who was of that wicked one, and slew his brother. And wherefore slew he him? Because his own works were evil, and his brother's righteous." Cain may have been religious, but he absolutely did not that which pleased God. He did not worship God in the right way. He was evil in his heart. The intents of his heart were only wicked and evil continually. Abel, on the other hand, came, presented that sacrifice, presented that offering unto God. He did it in the way that God had commanded, and it was accounted to him for righteousness. That's what the Apostle John is telling us here. That's how we know that he was accepted in the sight of God. Now, Cain's heart is further depicted to us, is it not, in verse 5? Tells us at the end there that as Cain comes to this knowledge that God has accepted Abel and his offering. God has regard unto Abel and to his offering, but he has not accepted Cain or his offering. Abel was very wroth, and his countenance fell. Oh, anger consumed him. He thought that what he had done was good enough, but just as his parents had found out in the Garden of Eden that their fig leaves of clothes or aprons that they had made for themselves, they were never enough to cover their shame, their guilt before God. Only the provision of the lamb, only the death of another could provide that proper covering in the sight of God. So too Cain was experiencing exactly the same here. That was, you cannot do anything to change your standing before God in and of yourself. It's not about what you can bring. It's not about what you can give. It's not about what you can do. Because God has appointed a way that man might know what it is to stand right before him. And today in this age, it is that blood-bought way as we come to confess our sin and believe in the Lord Jesus Christ alone for salvation. That is the only way that you can know what it is to stand right before God. Let's continue our reading, verse 6. "And the Lord said unto Cain, Why art thou wroth? Why is thy countenance fallen? If thou doest well, shalt thou not be accepted. If thou doest not well, sin lieth at the door, and unto thee shall be his desire, and thou shalt rule over him." God identifies within Cain, of course, that there's this anger, there's this rage, there's further manifestation of sin. And God comes to him and he says unto him, "Why art thou wroth? Why is thy countenance fallen?" And again, this is not God asking Cain a question because he needs to know the answer. God knows all things. Just as he came into the Garden of Eden and he said to Adam, Cain's father, "Where art thou, Adam?" After Adam had partaken of the fruit, he didn't need to ask that question. He could have came exactly to the tree, the bush that Adam was hiding behind. But no, he asked that question. Why? To promote and to prompt discussion. To promote and prompt the response. To get Adam to think for himself, think through what he was going to do and what he was going to say, just as we see here in the experience of Cain. God is coming to him and says, "Why are you wroth? Why is thy countenance fallen? Cain, why are you reacting like this? I've instituted a way. Why are you so cross and angry that I have not accepted your offering when you haven't done it the way that I have commanded?" He says in verse 7, "If thou doest well, shalt thou not be accepted?" This has nothing to do with the individual, Cain. This is nothing to do that Abel's a better kid than you are. No, not at all. This is all to do with the fact that you haven't obeyed me. Cain, think this through. And again, we see that God is not enforcing or mandating that man follow him. Not at all. God is allowing mankind, Cain, Abel, to express their own free will in the choices and decisions they make. And it's remained the same. And therefore, again, I say I cannot subscribe to that idea that a sovereign God simply forces his will upon mankind. And he has deemed people for salvation. He has deemed people for reprobation. Not at all. Cain here is being afforded a chance, another chance. He was afforded the chance, no doubt, in the presentation that Adam and Eve gave to their children, how they might worship God right, how that God himself had instituted this way of sacrifice in the Garden of Eden. There's no doubt in my mind that that was a testimony that they gave to their boys. And that choice was made by Cain. No, I'm not going to do that. I'm going to bring the fruits of the ground. But now God was coming to him again saying, Cain, here's another opportunity. Here's another moment where you can do what I have commanded, what I have instituted. You can come to me and worship me in the way that I have ordained. Cain rejects it. By his own will, he rejects it. And God says, if thou doest not well, sin lieth at the door. and unto thee shall be his desire, and I shall rule over him. Cain, you're going to run out of opportunities, but it's your decision. You can go away, get a lamb, come back, worship me appropriately, and you too will be accepted. But if you don't, you'll be forever lost in your sin. Cain, the choice is up to you. And understand again that this is an example of the free will being enacted in the choices that Cain made, that God has given to every man, every woman, every boy, and every girl. It tells us Cain talked with Abel, his brother. It came to pass when they were in the field that Cain rose up against Abel, his brother, and slew him. The Lord has said unto Cain, where is Abel thy brother? And he said, I know not, am I my brother's keeper? Oh, Cain didn't choose that which was right. He rejected again God's way. He rejected again true worship. He hardened his heart. Oh yes, God was speaking to him, but oh, he hardened his heart. Now come back to 1 John. And John again sheds that light. He says, not as Cain, who was of that wicked one and slew his brother, and wherefore slew he him? Because his own works were evil and his brother's were righteous. Verse 13, marvel not, my brethren, if the world hate you. This is why believers are persecuted. This is why believers are hated. This is why the world despises the preaching of God, the word of God, and the people of God. Because the unrighteous despise the righteous. And those who refuse to accept the very existence of God, those who refuse to accept the offer of salvation in the gospel, those who refuse to accept that God has instituted a way, the simple way of repentance and faith. Not that we have to bring lots of our own possessions, not that we have to prove our own worth, not at all. We come and we acknowledge our lack of worth, our sin, and we acknowledge his worth, faith in Jesus Christ. That's a simple way of salvation, but oh, so hard for so many in the world to accept. They harden their heart. They hate the message of the gospel. They hate the messengers of the gospel. They hate those who are the recipients of the gospel. And it's manifested here in the life of Cain. He rose up and he slew his brother. Again, we see that God asks him that question, where is Abel thy brother? Not because he needed to know, no. Simply because he is reminding Cain, consider the choice you've made. Consider the action you've now entered into. I know what you've done. There's no hiding it. It's time you faced up to what you've done. He says, what hast thou done? The voice of thy brother's blood crieth unto me from the ground. And now art thou cursed from the earth, which has opened her mouth to receive thy brother's blood from thy hand. When thou tillest the ground, it shall not henceforth yield unto thee her strength. A fugitive and a vagabond shalt thou be in the earth. Why did God not kill him in the moment, some people have asked? I subscribe to the idea that many say is simply because there was no form of human government instituted at this time. There was no laws that were established or set out, no precedent set even for the capital punishment, the taking of a life or the shedding of the blood of another one's life. No, I subscribe to that idea, but I truly believe that the overriding reason why God did not kill Cain in that moment was, first of all, he was dealing with the sinner once again in grace. It was not affording to the sinner an act of vengeance, but rather righteous judgment. And forever and a day, Cain would roam the face of the earth, and he would be a vagabond and a fugitive. He would know no acceptance, no place to call home. The door of mercy to him was shut forever. God had given him that moment to accept God's way of acceptance before him, obedience to the way that God had prescribed. But Cain had rejected it. And forever and a day, that door of mercy had closed for Cain. And he no longer would find acceptance in the family. He would no longer find a place to call home. He would roam the earth, a fugitive and a vagabond. And his would be a miserable existence. For the Bible tells us here he's doubly cursed. The curse, remember, was pronounced upon the ground in the days of Adam. Already, as Cain tilled the ground to get the fruits that he brought onto the Lord as his offering, he would have experienced the sweat of the brow, he would have experienced a sore back, he would have experienced the toil and labor in the field. Why? Because thorns, thistles, and briars were the curse that God had pronounced, and everything that came from the ground was to be a work of labor, a work of hard labor and graft would have went into that fruit that was brought forth. But now Cain was doubly cursed, for the ground no longer would yield to him at all. No matter how much he sweated, no matter how long or how hard he toiled, no, the ground was forever barren to him. And so his was a miserable existence. One who knew what it was to have that opportunity to please God, one who was then afforded another opportunity to consider his ways and to turn on to God but rejected it, now the door of mercy had shut. And friend, there's a stark warning in that, for that is truth still applicable today, that if one does not receive the offer of salvation in the gospel, there is a point determined by God in that person's experience here on earth that his spirit will stop striving, that that door of opportunity will close, and that forever they will be condemned as a reprobate, just as Cain was, to hell, to the final judgment, to everlasting torment. You know, the believer, on the other hand, is such a wonderful experience. They're saved by the amazing grace of God. They're grafted into the family of God. They know what it is to have a home heaven. They're part of a family of God here on earth, and they look forward to being part of the redeemed throng above. Oh, theirs is a testimony of acceptance. Theirs is a testimony of belonging right throughout. But not the sinner. The sinner will die and perish, go to hell, and alone will suffer in hell, tormented forever. It's all characterized here in the life of Cain, the one who pictures to us the reprobate, the rejecter of God's way of salvation. And friend, if you're outside of Christ, do not let that be you. But turn to Christ while his spirit is striving. Today, if you hear his voice, harden not your heart, but seek ye the Lord while he may be found. Call ye upon him while he is near. And he is near. If you hear his voice speaking, oh, he's so near, he's standing at your heart's door and he's knocking. Oh, reach out and touch the Lord as he passes by. Acknowledge who you are. Thank him for what he's done. And I close in on that mercy and grace available in the gospel tonight. But oh, Cain, he pictures to us one who is the legitimate receiver of the judgment of God. The Bible goes on and says in verse 13, Cain said unto the Lord, my punishment is greater than I can bear. Was he sorry for what he had done? No. And that sadly is the case for every a sinner. They remain unrepentant right to death. And forever, all eternity, they will receive the righteous everlasting judgment of God. Cain was just sorry here that he had been caught out, that he'd now have to bear this punishment in his life. He wasn't sorry for what he had done. He was still self-consumed, self-conceited. Still had a heart that was hardened against God. Behold, thou hast driven me out this day from the face of the earth. From thy face shall I be hid, and I shall be a fugitive and a vagabond on the earth. Cain acknowledges his day of opportunity is gone. And truly the sinner, as they look back upon their life and as they spend those years of reflection in hell, they'll reflect, they'll acknowledge that they too spurned their opportunity. They too turned their back on the grace of God that was extended. That's exactly what Cain is doing here. It shall come to pass that every one that findeth me shall slay me. The Lord said unto him, therefore whosoever slayeth Cain, vengeance shall be taken on him sevenfold. And the Lord set a mark upon Cain, lest any finding him should kill him. Part of the punishment that Cain received was a life of misery. And truly that is the sinner's condition. They're miserable in their sin now, but those who reject the offer of salvation, those for whom the Spirit of God stops striving, that door of opportunity closes, theirs is a miserable existence the remainder of their days. No contentment, no peace, no rest, no sense of belonging, no sense of achievement. And this is what happened in the life of Cain. Well, that's our thoughts there on Cain and Abel. We've expended a lot of time tonight, so we'll come quickly just to remark upon the person of Seth. Found for us in the verse 25 of the chapter, Adam knew his wife again, and she bare a son, and called his name Seth. For God, said she, hath appointed me another seed instead of Abel, whom Cain slew. And to Seth, and to him also, there was a son, and he called his name Enos. Then began men to call upon the name of the Lord. And so God here blesses Adam and Eve once again with the birth of another son. This son is called Seth, and he is that promised seed of God. It's from his line, of course, that the Lord Jesus Christ would come. And truly, the experience of his birth was no doubt a blessing in the moment to Adam and Eve, but the experience of his birth was a blessing to earth itself. For the Bible tells us that as he grew up and as he himself had children, then began men to call upon the name of the Lord. He was one too. We believe that honored God and lived in a consistent way to the commands of God. And that's a challenge for you tonight. It's a challenge for me tonight. Are we doing that which benefits the world in which we live? Not by social type works or acts or deeds. No. Are we living in a way that pleases God, and are we seeking to point other men to God? It's by the example, I believe, of Seth and Enos that men around the world, men upon earth at that time, were motivated and indeed guided to call upon the name of the Lord. And that reminds me that just as the birth of Seth was that blessing, is a promise of blessing yet to be, so too, you and I can be that blessing from God here upon earth right now. Are we fulfilling that? Are we those who come before the Lord with hearts that are right before Him, worship Him in that right and appropriate way, and give of ourselves entirely to pleasing Him, to bringing glory to His name? I pray that we will. I pray that we too will be those who see the work of God accomplished. And through our witness, through our testimony, through our service for God, that many men, many women will call upon the name of the Lord. I tell you, that is possible today. Do not despair and do not be burdened down thinking that we're in days when blessing cannot be known. Yes, these may be days of small things, but we can have our fair share of small things here, if we will but serve God and please Him each and every day of our lives. May God bless these thoughts to our hearts. And truly, as we continue this series, may we continue to grow in our love for God and in the knowledge of His Word. God bless.